Lifers, thank you so much for tuning in to today's episode of the 1010 podcast, where we talk about life and the abundant life that we can have through a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. It's been a little while, so if you're new to the 1010 podcast, I just want to let you know that the name 1010 comes from the scriptures from John chapter 10, verse 10, where it says, "The enemy has come to steal, kill, and destroy, but Jesus came that we could have life and abundant life." And that's what we're about. And you can see in the world how the enemy truly is working to steal, kill, and destroy, especially when it comes to life in the womb. And that's really one of the things that we focus on in this podcast. And so I'm so glad that you have joined us today. I have a special guest with me today that I know you are going to really be encouraged and inspired by her story. Her name is Rochelle Lathrop, and so let's get started. Yay, awesome. Rochelle, thank you so much for taking time out of your life to be willing to share your story to our lifers. That's what I call all of our followers on this channel, are lifers. You know, they support life, and, you know, and just when you think that the battle's over, it's not. You know, when you think of the next generation of young people growing up and how so much of like social media and just what they hear is, you know, that life isn't precious. They don't hear that message. And so the stories that we share and your story is all really all about teaching the next generation how precious life is to the Lord. And also that, you know, life outside of the womb is precious. So our lives are precious, and the things that happen to us matter. And sometimes, you know, we go through really hard times in life, you know, think bad things happen to us, but it's what we do with that that matters. So life in the womb is precious, life out of the womb is precious, but our connection is I'm really good friends with your sister, Miss Brittany Shorb. And she's like, "You've got to have my sister on your show. You got to hear her story." And so that is why you are here today, because your sister said you had a great story. And so just introduce yourself to all of our viewers and let us know maybe how you grew up, a little bit about you.
Yeah. Well, I grew up in a strong Christian home. I grew up down in Olympia, Washington. And both sides of my family, strong believers and been in the church for a long time. And so I don't really know a life without it. Mm-hmm. I remember I was 4 and remember going down to the altar and giving my life to the Lord. So, you know, like I said, I didn't really know a life without that. That's part of it. Church was a huge part of our lives, you know, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, yep, all the nights of the week that we were there. and really such a great experience and all that. I was the good kid. I was, you know, the last one that anybody probably thought anything would make the wrong choices to kind of get where I was. Mm-hmm. But my freshman year of college, I went to University of Washington and got involved with someone there that just wasn't real healthy. And there was a little bit of abuse that he, sexual abuse that he kind of did to me. And it just messed me up enough to not really have my head on very straight. Mm-hmm. And I met a young man at the time, and I was just really hurting. And I didn't get help for that experience prior to that. And so I think that when I met him, and just, even though I didn't really, the feelings weren't super strong, I think it was just that anything that was telling me that I was pretty or was loved or something just felt good.
Yeah.
And so I ended up getting pregnant at 19, end of my freshman year of college. Wow. And again, it was just really tough because I was so scared to tell my parents. I was so worried about, you know, what everybody would think and what life was going to look like. Yeah. And I found out on a Sunday afternoon, and I had two of my closest friends there with me when I found out. Mm. And I stayed really calm, and I was like, okay. And so I went to church that night over in Seattle. And I remember just going up to the altar and being like, how am I going to do this? How am I going to tell my folks? Mm-hmm. You know, what am I going to do? Mm-hmm. And I started praying, and a gal started praying with me, and I told her my circumstance. And the Lord laid on my heart the story of Abraham and how he had longed for a son for so long. And then God asked him to sacrifice his son Isaac. Mm-hmm. And literally the Lord just audibly said to me, will you give me this child? Mm-hmm. And I don't know how long, you know, what the next few seconds were like or anything, but I was like, yes, Lord, I will lay this child down on the altar. And I knew that day that I was going to do an adoption.
Wow.
And it was such a blessing to have that that, just knowing that that was the decision for me. I really have said all along that I really felt like I got pregnant so that another family could become a family. And this was in 1991. Okay. And open adoption was just really beginning. And so that, I went down to see my parents. I let them know, you know, had the hard conversation to tell my mom and dad. And, but I was so firm in my decision. I said, but the Lord's told me I'm going to do an adoption. And so my parents got me into some counseling, and then I connected with a ministry through Overlake Church at the time called Special Delivery. And they had a ministry that worked with moms that were pregnant, and they had a parenting group, and then they had a group that was doing doing adoptions. And again, in 1991, open adoption was really just beginning. And so they're not an adoption agency, but they worked with some different attorneys and adoption attorneys. And so I started looking through portfolios. So here I am, 19 years old, and you're given these, you know, little booklets about a family telling you why you should pick them and what they would do for you. And I think now that I'm older and have had other kids, you're like, that is a big thing for a 19-year-old to go, okay, I'm going to pick who's going to raise this child that I'm, you know, that the Lord's given me that I'm pregnant with. And so thankfully through Special Delivery, I had great support, and I found a couple. I interviewed two different couples, and I remember interviewing the first couple and, you know, just asking questions, and I don't even think I knew what to ask. You know, I didn't, I wasn't, it's just not the place that we were meant to be in, you know, it wasn't meant to have to think of how to, who to give my child to. So I remember one of the funny things they said, I liked that they had been married for about 8 years and hadn't had any kids. My parents were married for a little bit longer before they had me. I was the oldest. I was really, I really liked the idea of my this child being the oldest. And in that family, just kind of a similar life that I had. And I just remember them saying that, like, divorce isn't in their vocabulary. It's just not something. They said murder was, but, you know, not divorce. And I just, I loved that sense of humor and the way they said that. So that was really important to me. And interviewed another couple, and that just, there wasn't much of a connection there. And so I called them, and I was only 3 months pregnant. So I found out quite early that I was pregnant, and I chose them at about 11 weeks.
Wow.
So there's a lot of, you know, 29 weeks to go of living with that decision, making that decision. And back in 1991, again, as open adoption was just starting, there was this, okay, you shared your first name, but you didn't share too much information because what if that, you know, it would, you could give something away. The birth mom might know where you live and come. So there was just a lot of unknowns at that point in time. And I was so secure in my decision that one of the things that just kind of bugged me was I wasn't going to know her last name or the, I didn't know what it was then, a baby's last name. And there was just was like, how do I have closure if I don't even know, you know, who she is? And, but chose them. And so we met once a month up until she was born. Introduced my parents to them when I was probably 8 months pregnant, and just really had a neat connection. And it was at one of those visits prior to having her, and I didn't know if it was having a boy or a girl. We didn't find out. And so I asked them, you know, her, what names they had thought of. And they gave me the boy's name, and I don't even remember. And then they said, and if it's a girl, we're going to name her Sandra Marie. And I was like, oh, where did that name, you know, how'd you get that name? And they said, oh, well, our really good friend is a missionary. Her name's Sandra. And then we just like the name Marie. And I said, well, that's my middle name. And they didn't know it. So that was just one of those things that was really cool. That was really neat to have, you know, just again, God's affirmation of what this was. And so, but we didn't know if we were having a boy or a girl. And so my pregnancy progressed and everything was good. And right about the time that I was due, I was at one of my appointments, and it was discovered that the baby was turned and the baby was breached. And so they wanted me to go in and do a procedure where they kind of manually turn her. And again, I'm 19 years old, so these things kind of sound scary. And so I went into the hospital on a Wednesday morning for them to turn her, and then I was just going to go home until I went into labor. And they got her turned, but there was some complications with it, and they felt that she was just in a really precarious position. So they attempted to induce my labor, and in the end, I had an emergency C-section that evening. But I think my one of my parents' biggest concerns my entire pregnancy was that I would change my mind. You have the baby, spend time with the baby, and then you would change your mind. In Washington State, the birth mom has minimum 48 hours with the baby before custody can be given to the adoptive family. Well, if the baby's born after 5 o'clock on a Wednesday, court can't happen until Monday morning.
Okay.
And my biggest, again, I think one of my parents' big fears was I was going to have this baby at like 5:30 on a Wednesday. And, you know, we'd be, how would this work out? Well, right. She was born at about 8:30 on a Wednesday evening. And delivered healthy. She was totally fine. But now we had until Monday before they could take the baby home. And thankfully, back then, they didn't kick you out of the hospital super fast.
Yeah.
And the doctor allowed us to stay in the hospital those entire 5 days. And we really had a pretty amazing time as families together. They lived in Everett at the time. So they came back down that next morning and they stayed in Olympia through Sunday.
Okay.
Where we just had an amazing time of bonding and funny experiences. We had over 30 people come through the hospital to visit. So
wow.
Most of my family met her, you know, adoptive parents, and we just really bonded. And Sunday we decided, so she was going home on Monday, and that Sunday we decided that we would just kind of shut down all visitors and just have just kind of the next 24 hours or so just to ourselves. Her parents went home because they had not really bought anything for her. They had had a failed adoption prior, and they were nervous. So they had to go buy, you know, diapers, a crib, everything.
Oh, wow.
And so I had those next 24 hours to just, you know, really spend time with her and think about it, time with my family. And that night was difficult for sure, but the reality was my circumstance hadn't changed. You know, I wished that things were different, but reality was they weren't. The dad still wasn't really involved. He didn't come to the hospital. And so I knew that what I was doing was still the right decision. And so we had it set up legally that I would see her one time when she was 6 months old. I would get multiple letters a year for the first few years, and then I would get a letter once a year until she was 18 years old. So Monday morning came along, and my youth pastor did a baby dedication service.
Uh-huh.
And so my youth pastor and his wife and a couple other people came, and we dedicated her to the Lord, and I handed her over. And I remember, you know, then all of a sudden they've got to pack up their bags and go. And thank you. Didn't think I'd cry about this.
Yeah.
And I just remember thinking, I'm going to miss them, not just her, this little girl. They gave me a beautiful locket that had her birth date in it. And it was a loss to, you know, you really felt like you were relinquishing this relationship that had started in a bond that you can't really define or compare to anything else. But I knew that she was going, you know, where she should be. And so she went home that day and, you know, we went our separate ways.
Wow.
And it was definitely, you know, a grieving process and difficult. But I never, because I knew so I was so determined that what the Lord had told me was right and that this was a baby so that they could become a family.
Yeah.
It really became a gift more than a sacrifice.
That's awesome.
And so it was really neat. But I was like, I was going to be sad. Like, well, I would have loved hanging out with these people, you know, just really neat. And so she was born in February. And a couple months after she was born, my girlfriend and I went up to Pike Place for the day. And I actually said to her that morning, I said, I have a feeling we're going to see them. Like, it was just kind of strange. Didn't know what it was. And so we were just doing Pike Place Market, and all of a sudden, there they were.
Wow.
And I remember looking at my girlfriend going, are they going to think I'm, like, stalking them?
Right.
I mean, Pike Place Market. I lived in Olympia. Yeah. They lived in Everett.
That's
it wasn't like we lived in the same
likely.
Town at the time. And so we went up to them, and I was like, hi. And they gave me a big hug, and they were so happy to see me. And we chatted for a while, and then Mike, her dad, took her out of the stroller, and here came this, you know, adorable little blonde, somewhat bald kiddo, and she looked at her dad and gave him the biggest smile, and it was just the confirmation that I needed that she was right where she was supposed to be.
Yeah.
And so we had a really neat, we talked for probably about 20 minutes, and it was really fun, and we walked away, and I was okay. I mean, it was sad. I think I cried. I called my mom and dad. You know, back in the day, when I had to have a calling card number to call them a long distance from a payphone. I'm like, you'll never believe who I saw.
Wow.
And so it was just really a neat experience and just made it really, it was really good for me. It was something that I think I needed to just see that she was where she should be. And so that was in probably April or May. And then that summer, we had a visit scheduled.
Okay.
It was going to be on a Sunday afternoon, and we were going to see him, and it was going to be the one time I would see her. And the day before that visit, we were at the Evergreen State Fair out in Monroe, and we ran into them again. And she was on their shoulders, and all of a sudden I heard my mom kind of give this squeal. And I looked over, and here's this cute little fat kiddo, you know, on her dad's shoulders. And her parents, again, were like, hey, how's it going? And it was never anything they were ashamed of or shy about or anything. Yeah. And so we sat and chatted with them. My uncle was right. It was just neat. More people got to see her and meet them. And we had the visit the next day, and I just remember leaving there. I went to church afterwards, but I remember just thinking, I'm kind of sad. Like, 18 years felt like a really, really, really long time at that point in time, and I probably wasn't going to see her anymore. And I was bummed, but I just knew, again, that I was just still doing the right thing and where she was supposed to be. So I still went through the ministry at special delivery at Overlake Church, and was quite involved with that. And the director of that ministry were my daughter's parents, young marrieds, Sunday school teachers, so they were really close to him. So Christmas came around, and so Sandra would have been 10 months old, and I said to Nellie, the director, I said, hey, could I send some gifts or something? I would just love to send him something. And later that night, Denise, her mom, called me and said, hey, you know, heard from Nellie, would you guys want to get together? Would you want to, you know, do something around Christmas time? And I said, oh, yeah, that would be wonderful. So Sandra and her mom and dad and her grandma came down to my parents' house in Olympia, and we had a blast. I mean, we just really, again, those 5 days in the hospital were pretty relationship building, and we really had a lot of fun. And that night her dad said, how would you feel about keeping this relationship going?
Wow.
And I said, I'm game. I had pretty good boundaries, and just as long as it's healthy for all of us, I'd love to. And so they invited us to her first birthday party. That was Christmas time, and February 5th, they invited us to her party. And I remember they gave me a corsage when I walked in and said, you know, we wouldn't be here if you weren't with us, and if, you know, you hadn't done what you did. And so we had a really neat time that night. And so the first couple years of her life, I let them reach out to me. I didn't pursue. They pursued me. They went to church. I would go to church with them, and people would, you know, they were never shy. They're like, this is Rochelle, Sandra's birth mom. And it was never something they were ashamed of or shy about. And we just started to do more and more together. We were at the mall one time, and we look a lot alike. It's very obvious who she came from when we're near each other. And one funny instance was she was getting her ears pierced, and her mom, you know, filled out the gal at the store said, oh, the mom needs to fill out the form. And I just keep my mouth shut.
Yeah.
And Denise goes, okay. So she takes it, and the gal goes, she looks more like her mom, like the mom.
She said that.
That's what the gal said. And Denise, her mom goes, probably because she gave birth to her.
Oh, my
And the gal
word.
Was just so taken back, and she said, does she know that? Like, she whispered it as this two-year-old, almost three-year-old.
Oh, the baby.
Watching back and forth, right? Yeah. And she's like, well, she didn't. She does now, huh? You know, and so it was kind of fun because it would just shock people, and we kind of, I think, got a little bit of joy out of that shock.
Yes,
and
yes,
so
yes.
Those first couple of years, they really, you know, they would ask if we want to get together. They actually asked if I would watch her overnight one night when she was two. They went fishing, and so they left her, you know, at our house, and I got to take her to church, and it was really fun.
But that's amazing.
By the time they were coming back to pick her up, I was, I think, on the front porch, like, and here you go. I mean, I was 23 years old and not a mom.
Wow.
And, but it was really just a neat experience. And so she grew up knowing her entire life that she was adopted and that I was her birth mom, as she would say when she was little and couldn't pronounce her TH. And we'd go places and people would say, you look just like your mom. And she'd go, oh, no, that's Shell. She's just my birth mom. And so that was kind of our thing because we looked so much.
She's just my birth mom.
Just my birth mom. So it was just something that obviously Cheryl always knew. Her parents did adopt another child, another little girl. So she had a sister. Mm-hmm. And it was just a really neat relationship. We all went to Hawaii together one Thanksgiving.
Wow.
So our family's just really connected and bonded. And it was a really neat experience. And so, you know, as I was growing and getting older, there's this interesting relationship between, you know, myself and her and her adoptive parents. And it's a very odd experience to watch someone else raise, you know, the child that you gave birth to. And again, I always knew. So there were some challenges here and there with that. Mm-hmm. But it was such a neat experience to have, to be able to be in her life. And again, she knew all of my grandparents. She knew all of my family. And it was just such a cool time to be able to see how God can work that. I mean, we never, ever imagined that it would be anything like that. And it really, we really became a family in a different way. And it was just a joy to watch her grow up. And she went through some challenges and, you know, again, hard to kind of, it'd be easy for me to, you know, parent while not the parent.
Right.
And so I think God really had to teach me how to just step back and mind my boundaries and let her be their parents. Mm-hmm. But I know that as she has gotten older, that it's probably more for those times than it was when she was younger, that we can, you know, speak life, talk, speak truth, and be a part of it. And there were some different dynamics as I began to get, I got married and had my own daughter. And, you know, I remember McKenna at one point in time when she was probably 5 or 6, she's like, I don't understand how, you know, if you gave birth to her, why does somebody else have her? And I was able to just share that obviously it was God's plan that, you know, they couldn't have kids. And so he took that experience with me and allowed me to, you know, to give a gift that is, you know, so cherished and amazing. And so it was really it's been an incredible experience to be a part of her life. That's and amazing. And for my girls to, you know more about adoption and know that, you know, things can be redeemed.
Yeah.
And she's 33 now and has a couple kids of her own. And her parents live in Snohomish, and she lives in Arizona now. But it's just always been a really positive relationship. Again, we've had some challenges, and there's been some times where...
Well, that's any family.
In any family, right? Yeah, right?
I mean,
it's
any
no
relationship.
Different than anything else. You just kind of have a couple extra people in it.
Yes.
You know, for us. But it has been just such a joy to... and it's fun because we do look, even to this day, she probably looks more like me than even my other girls do. And it's fun to have. And my, you know, she has kids now. So I'm BG, the birth grandma.
Yeah.
And so it's been neat as we've had those roles and been able to just kind of share in life together.
That is such a beautiful story. I wonder how common that story is.
You know, so I've had the opportunity to work with, I don't know, probably 100 birth moms over the years. And mine is definitely one of the more extreme open adoptions. Mm-hmm. The most, there are, I know, a handful of people that still have ongoing relationship with their kids. And it's been neat to walk through that with other women, because I think, as you know, when you have an experience like that, it's, no one understands it. Mm-hmm. No one ever fully understands your story, but for someone that's walked through it, you know, and has done that, that there's been a ton of opportunities for me to share our story and to just kind of come beside, whether it's the mom of the girl that's pregnant, or I've been in the delivery room many, many times and watched a lot of really neat adoptions take place.
Really?
So I think that, you know, more open than it was, and it just really depends on the relationship between and the boundaries and how healthy each family is.
Right.
So, but for us it worked.
Do you, because you mentioned the ministry that you were part of at that time. Mm-hmm. Is that ministry still?
It's not. I was involved with it for a long time. I did my internship through Northwest, and it was really neat to be able to work with girls and, again, to just kind of walk alongside of that. So unfortunately, that ministry is not going any longer. But, you know, I still occasionally get a phone call or, hey, would you talk to more adoptive parents now than anything, but,
So you just kind of do it freelance.
Word of
mouth
when the spirit leads or whenever the circumstance happens, that I've been able to just kind of share our story and our openness. And again, I mean, she has a mom and a dad, you know, I'm not mom.
No.
It's, you know, definitely, but it is neat that my girls get to know, you know, my other two get to know their sister and be a part of that whole story and really just be an extended family. And it's been pretty incredible.
Well, I feel like, you know, you often hear the stories from the adoptive parents' perspective of like not being able to have kids or choosing, you know, to have to adopt first before they would start their family. And it's not very often that we get to hear, you know, from the mom's perspective of like that process.
And I just think it's so unfortunate because what you hear is usually the negative, right? You hear those extreme stories of it not going well.
Yes, I've heard
and
so many of those.
For every one of those, there's got to be so many more on the positive side of things, whether or not it's as open as ours is.
Right. Yeah.
But I still think that, you know, the gift is still amazing and it works differently. I've got a really close friend who, we became close after she got pregnant. She did adoption. Her story looks very different than mine. And and it's fine for them. It works really well for them. And for us, this works really well too. And so it's, You know, it's different. We've shared some life's experiences together that is just when you have a child at 20, it's a different relationship. Mm-hmm. You know, as you get older, those ages tend to kind of get a little small, you know, get a little, it just changes, you know, you just get a little closer as you get older. So I, you know, truly think of her as one of just a really good, one of my true friends. We're very close and yet she has a mom and dad and her mom and dad are her mom and dad.
Yeah.
So I don't try or need to be mom.
Yeah.
It's just how God wanted it to work out.
Yeah.
And it's been, you know, again, there's been hard times, but it's been pretty amazing and I love to be able to share about it.
I know that God has purposes for everything.
Mm-hmm.
The good things and even the bad things or seemingly bad, right, that happen in our life. It's just something that God's really been instilling in me lately that there's a purpose in everything, in every season.
Mm-hmm.
He creates purpose, you know, and some of those, it's like we don't really know, but just knowing that there is purpose in it, and it may not even be about you,
right,
you know, or even about her, but what God's doing in other areas through that story and through that circumstance. God is always working out his purposes and his plans. And it's crazy to me how even in like Christian circles, I hear some people just talk like so negatively even about adoption. Mm-hmm. And it's like, I don't like that because it's an option.
Mm-hmm.
Adoption is a really, really good option for people, you know, who find themselves in those difficult situations, especially when, you know, you're, like you'd said, you're not with the dad, you know, he wasn't around.
Right.
And for you to be able to not just do something that was selfish for you, but to be able to say, like, I want the best for this life.
Well, I really felt like I couldn't make any other choice because I knew I couldn't give her what she needed.
Mm-hmm.
So how selfish would that have been of me to keep her because it was going to be hard.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, life's hard. That's just how it goes. You know, pick your hard, right?
Yep.
Like parenting would have been difficult.
Mm-hmm.
Relinquishing and choosing adoption was difficult.
Yeah.
You pick your hard in life. And
yes.
And in the end, you know, the Lord was totally glorified through it all. And it's been just a pretty incredible experience.
Yeah.
And again, you know, there's times where it was harder than others and, you know, they make choices that you're like, oh, didn't I walk through that path so that you wouldn't have to go down that path? But, you know, but you're like, you need to do that too.
Exactly.
But it's been really amazing to see the nurture versus nature.
Yep.
And she lives in Arizona and my parents were down that way. And so my mom, they had dinner with her and her boys. And my mom's like, I felt like I sat and had dinner with you. I mean, it is incredible how much our expressions and the way we talk. And again, I didn't raise her.
Yeah.
Are just so much alike. Our likes and our dislikes are very similar.
Yeah.
And so it's always just kind of funny to, you know, at times where I go, oh my gosh, that was me. You know, I see it in me and all
That's
that.
So cool.
It's a really,
And it's cool how, I mean, I can see it in the way that you're talking about her, that you just felt that, like, you know, from the moment you found out you were pregnant, you just really knew that.
Mm-hmm.
And I love that that happened at the altar, you know, in church. And I think, you know, there's a statistic about abortions that women, that's like nearly 50% of women who have abortions have been in a church service within a month of their abortion.
Really? I can understand
and that's,
that.
And that's like you. That's like me.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So there's women, there's young women, old women in our congregations, in our bodies that are in that place of decision.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I don't know if abortion was ever something that like you contemplated or...
I mean, I think you think about it because you're like, oh my goodness, how do I,
you
know, how am I going to do this? You know, how do I tell my parents and all that?
But yes.
Again, I think it could have been a different story and it would have looked a little bit different if I hadn't gone to church that day. I think that, you know, thankfully having a relationship with the Lord prior to that, just, I knew the power of prayer. I knew the peace that he can give.
Yeah.
And I mean, I will say to this day that I'm super grateful that happened on day one. I mean, I felt really fortunate. I've again, walked alongside so many different women and almost feel like I kind of cheated or something because it was, again, it was not easy,
right.
But I never doubted that.
Yeah.
And I'm really grateful for that. And, you know, maybe that's why we can't have the relationship that we do or whatever it is. But yeah, it's, you know, I remember thinking so many times, like when people say, oh, I just couldn't do that. Well, I would have said that too.
Right.
When I wasn't in that
like,
situation.
Like, isn't it funny to look back and you think of your 19-year-old self?
Yeah.
Like you were saying, choosing your child's parents.
That's not what you're supposed to be doing.
And like, that's just the grace of God.
Yeah.
Otherwise, how would you have even... I mean, I even look back on, you know, my marriage, like when you're 18, 19, like, how do you even know what makes a good husband?
Right, right.
You
or
know
a good
what
wife.
I mean? Or how to be a good wife. Yeah. And so the fact that God, you know, just helps us.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He just like, when we ask for his help, and even if we're like, we feel like we're just stumbling along, like he just helps us, puts us on the path.
And I will say that I think when people said, oh, I just don't think I could have ever done that. I couldn't have done it without the Lord.
Right.
I mean, again, the peace that passes all understanding was what I was given that day. And so that's been, you know, I feel very blessed to have had that opportunity. Love to believe that I would have done the same thing even if I hadn't, but, you know, grateful for that every day. It just was such a neat, and it just, you know, when you, I think growing up in, you know, growing up in Pentecostal church and all that, you hear a lot of people hearing the Lord and things like that. But when you finally experience that on your own, it's pretty, you know, earth moving.
And that God spoke to you in a season where, I mean, you weren't making good choices. Like you hadn't done the right thing.
Right.
And yet you still humbled yourself and prayed, and God answered your prayer and like led you and guided you. I think that shows God's character.
Yeah, for sure.
That he's loving, he's forgiving, and that being pregnant is not sin.
Right. Right.
You know, like,
yeah, I remember being embarrassed or something one day, and my grandma just said, you know, honey, you're wearing your sin on the outside. Everybody
else
gets to cover theirs up.
I love that.
And it was such a good, it just made me feel like, oh, okay, I'm not different. I mean, sure, there were those that, you know, I had an experience where a few months after I had her, I was at church and I was holding our pastor's grandson, and someone said, oh, you didn't have another one, did you? So you definitely, and it was like, not my kid. You know, so you definitely, you know, there were definitely times of hurt and things that preconceived ideas of who I was. But until you share your story, nobody knows. You know, and I think that's the one thing that until you've walked in, you know, in those shoes, it's really easy to judge and say what should or shouldn't be done. But I just, you know that that experience gave me an opportunity to learn to step back and then go, okay, you know, maybe when I see somebody walking through something and think they shouldn't be doing that, you know, that's, I haven't walked in those shoes. I haven't known. And so I just, I love that these are the shoes that God gave me and the path that he chose for me to walk. I'm grateful for all of it. I'm grateful for the negative experiences before that, that led me to that, because I got to help a family be a family that, you know, weren't able to do it on their own prior to that. So that was a pretty amazing, you know, blessing from something that, you know, was a pretty hard and
was a mistake or was, you know, a sin.
Yeah.
Whatever
sin,
you might look at it. It's crazy to me because, you know, I believe that every pregnancy is God orchestrates it. You know, God, the Bible talks many times, you know, God opens the womb, God closes the womb. Like, God's the one who gives life. Only God can take life. And so many times I've thought, like, you know, when in my situation, because Jay and I literally, like, barely one time. Barely one time. And you're like, what are the odds?
That was my first time.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Like, what are the odds? There, it seems to me they're not very good.
Right.
So it, you know, and so I just think God did that.
Yeah.
Like, God allowed that life to be formed, you know, and so, like, on one hand, it's like hard because you know, I made a decision that wasn't God honoring and that wasn't godly or right, but yet he still chose to create a miracle out of it.
Right.
You know, and their life. I mean, the life itself is a miracle. You know, and even in your situation, like, God didn't have to create that life.
Right.
Right. He didn't have to allow that to happen.
Right.
But he did for a purpose.
Yeah.
And every life is on purpose. And I think that's, you know, when you think about, even with, if it's like rape, situations of rape, or, you know, it's a one night stand, or just all the reasons that people might choose to have an abortion. That life was created by God, was allowed to happen because God thought that that person should be here.
Yeah. Right.
And, that's the idea that I want people to think about as they're contemplating, you know, maybe like, oh, I'm pregnant. I don't want to be pregnant. Okay, I get that. It's scary. Mm-hmm. You know, I've been there. I know it's hard to talk to your family. It's hard to tell your church. It's hard to like walk through life with that. But that's just a momentary feeling, right? Like those feelings are gone. They've been gone for 20 plus years, 27 years, you know? But what's the joy that's come from choosing life, choosing to give your child life and to, you know, to honor God in that, like, far outweighs any of the embarrassment or the anxiety of that season. And that's where that John 10:10 just is just in full view, where you see where the enemy's like, destroy this life. Like, this life is going to be a burden to you. This life is going to bring embarrassment to you. People aren't going to understand, but God's over here like, I gave this life for a purpose. Yeah, I mean, it's really, you know, it's heartbreaking to think of how many people are not here today because people believed the lies of the enemy. You know, you think of young people, I think of all the students even in our school, Cedar Park Christian School, who are growing up, and many of them will be faced with, whether it's them or a friend or a family member who's faced with that decision of like, am I going to choose to do the right thing, or am I going to succumb to like shame or weakness? You know, and I just think your story is such a beautiful example of how even, you know, just a, like we admit our sin, like, yeah, it happened. I'm pregnant, but this life is precious, and that you were able to pray, you know, go to church, pray with your friends, pray with godly women, and that they came around you. And sounds like you had a similar experience to me in terms of the way the church, because I had so many women that came up to me after, you know, it kind of became news I was expecting, where they would say, you know, my husband and I, like, that happened to us, only I didn't get pregnant.
Right.
And it was just their way of telling me, like, hey, you're not alone.
Yeah.
Like, we've all made mistakes. And I know not everyone struggles in that area or has, you know, had sex before their marriage and before they're married, and good for them. Like, that's the goal. The goal is to save yourself for marriage. And it is possible. I know it is. You know, but the enemy loves to sneak in and just, you know, beat you down when you have made mistakes and say, oh, you're, you know, you're just damaged goods now, or God isn't going to use you. And those are all just lies. And your story, I think, is just such a testimony to, even in the middle of your drama and your crisis, the Lord's like, I'm here. I'm going to lead you.
For sure. And it's just, you know, we just gained family members. You know? It was just, we just grew our family by a little bit more.
It's like, it's a new grandchild. It's a new child. It's, you know, it's a sister, it's a sibling, it's a cousin. It's.
Well, and I think even in the times where, you know, someone tries to make you feel bad for it or something like that, there's learning experiences in that too. And that builds, you know, a resilience, or it builds your story in a different way that you can, you know, for me, I think it made me stand prouder, honestly, because I knew that I had chosen something that not everybody was able to do.
And so,
you know, whether that was a strength that was there before or a strength that the Lord gave me, I think it was kind of a combination of both for myself. But I've, you know, I, like I said, I've just kind of loved that story every day of my life since it's happened, and know that, again, I wouldn't relate to some people that I do relate to now. And I've gotten to walk with women who, you know, have then been able to find their children after a closed adoption prior to that. And just the amount of, the number of people that I've just seen, you know, become a family. I run into different, because I was involved in that ministry for so long. I mean, I recently ran into a couple that I remember when they adopted their daughter. Like, and they didn't know me then, but like, you know, 28 years later, it's pretty neat to say, oh my gosh, I remember when she was born. And so it is neat how, you know, that just continually comes back. And even the group of women that I helped lead with, and the, that we were in leadership, we're still close. I mean, the director is probably close to her 90s. She's still alive, and I still keep in touch with her. I mean, I just texted her on Thanksgiving. So it is really neat that just the people that would not have been in my life if those choices weren't made. And so it's pretty cool to be really grateful for that.
I love that.
Very much so.
That's such an amazing story. And I'm sure if, I know we had kind of maybe had the opportunity of your daughter being here, but didn't work out. But, you know, just hearing like the child's perspective now as an adult, you know, just, I don't know what, I know you can't necessarily speak for her, but I'm sure she's so thankful that you not only chose life, but, you know, chose to give her a mom and a dad. And,
yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, it, I think that she, I mean, she fits in with, we just all fit together really well. Like I said, mm-hmm. when that day that they left the hospital, you felt, it wasn't just this loss of a of the child that I had given birth to. It was like a loss of a relationship that mm-hmm. didn't have a long time to form, but mm-hmm. I mean, that's a pretty strong relationship at that yeah. point in time. And so, yeah. I mean, the number of people that I've met because of it and, mm-hmm. you know, people in their lives and everything else, it's really yeah. been just such a neat experience. And yeah. And I'm kind of one of those people that I see people I know wherever I go. So it's really fun to be. I mean, I've been places where they're like, wait, are you Sandra's birth mom? Because we look so much alike. But yeah. That's been funny too. Where it's yeah. like, I remember hearing about you and yeah. and things like that. So I think that she, you know, she's had some hard roads that she's walked down as well. And, mm-hmm. but I don't think she would trade it for the world either. Yeah. You know, and it's, we have a lot of fun and mm-hmm. a neat relationship yeah. when she's around. And, you know, I mean, she became a mom pretty young, and so she made me, you know, everything was just a lot younger than I thought it would be. Like, you know, so to be a grandma in my 30s was weird, but being a mom in my, you know, when I tell people now that I, you know, have a 33-year-old, a 22-year-old, a 10-year-old, I'm like, there's a little bit of an age difference there, you know? So it is just, it's just been a really amazing experience
yeah.
for sure.
God is, he's always full of surprises.
Yeah.
Yeah. It is, and children truly are a blessing from the Lord.
Mm-hmm, for sure.
You know, would there be any advice or encouragement that you might give to a young girl, maybe who is in a similar situation as you were in, or, you know, maybe even a family who's considering adoption? I don't know. I feel like you have so much wisdom.
Well, you know, there are other options out there besides, you know, and when you keep something hidden, it doesn't grow in the dark. Nothing, you know, yeah. we don't grow things in the dark.
Right.
And so bringing it to light, I mean, mm-hmm. it was hard as it was to make the decision, is that you will have people that stand beside you.
Yeah.
And I think that that's probably one of the things that I say, and that, you know, adoption is an incredible experience. And it can be, again, mm-hmm. my story is extreme, which might scare some off.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, I know birth moms that have yeah. not met their child and still know that yeah. they made the right decision. And so I think to just know that there's more than just the quick fix that isn't a quick fix.
Right.
You know, and that, again, you have to choose your heart, and all decisions that you make are tough, but, you know, life is the right decision, and I'm grateful mm-hmm. that that's what I was able to do, and that's what I hope everybody chooses, because
yeah.
we know, we all know somebody who struggles to have yep. kids. I mean, infertility is huge anymore, and,
yeah.
you know, I wish that more girls would choose adoption so that families could become families.
Yeah, and if there is, you know, a young woman out there who just feels like, I don't have yeah. what you had, like I don't have a family or a church community,
mm-hmm.
I would just encourage you to look for a church this
yeah.
weekend.
Yeah.
Because I know not all churches are the same.
Right.
But if in pray and just ask God to lead you to a community, mm-hmm. Because you're not alone. Like
right.
nobody's alone, and I've just heard that if a woman knows that even just one person
yeah.
is with her, that yeah. she can, you know, face a pregnancy.
Yeah. And I mean, I would be willing to talk to anybody mm-hmm. who wanted to know the story mm-hmm. and how it worked. And as would my daughter's adoptive parents and her parents and her, mm-hmm. you know, we all could come beside and say,
yeah.
hey, here's why
yeah.
it was a great decision for us. And, mm-hmm. and there are a lot of, you know, there, most churches are going to be able to point you in the right direction,
yeah.
I think, for
yes.
something like that. But
yeah, and we know, like, it's not just about just have the baby, you know, but like at our church, you know, we have a ministry for single moms, mm-hmm. so we continue to provide support for mm-hmm. those moms. We have a group called Embrace Grace, and it's really geared for single moms who are pregnant, mm-hmm. or, you know, maybe it's their first baby, so maybe you're just pregnant, you're not a single mom yet.
Yeah.
You're maybe a single pregnant person.
Yeah.
Where you can get training on how to, you know, walk through how to be a mom, but also a baby shower.
Mm-hmm.
We want to provide the physical things that you need, and also the emotional and relational support is there. And so we don't want to just say, just have the baby, that's the most important thing. But because we know, obviously, having a baby is hard, and being a parent is a lot of work. And so we totally advise church community. It's a great way to raise a family.
Right.
You know, not do it on your own. And the point is, you're not alone. I think maybe if you feel alone, you just need to pray and ask mm-hmm. God to bring you to a community, and then, you know, let your feet hit the sidewalk and find yeah. yourself a church community that you can plug into. And that would be my encouragement to anybody listening to this story today.
Yes.
Wow. I loved hearing your story. Oh, Brittany was right.
Thank you for the opportunity to share it.
Yeah. Thank you, Rochelle, so much for sharing your story of adoption and just letting us kind of hear a little bit about what that process was like for you and for even for your family.
Sure.
You know, it's not just you, but it's everybody who knows you and loves you walks through that together. Yeah. And what a blessing that is to her life, to Sandra's life, and Sandra Marie.
Sandra Marie.
It's beautiful. My mom's middle name is Marie, too. It's a very common good name.
Yes, it is, yeah. But it was pretty cool when I heard that that's what they wanted to name her.
Yes, that was so special. Yeah, for sure. I love that. Sure. Well, I just want to say, if you were listening to this podcast today and it spoke to your heart, just maybe maybe God brought someone to your mind who needs to hear this. I would just encourage you to share this podcast with just anybody that you know, that you love, who might benefit from hearing the story and find encouragement. Also, like and subscribe to this podcast on whatever channel you're watching it, whether it's Spotify or YouTube or Apple Podcasts. We'd love just to maybe even leave a review. That would be really helpful. But obviously, the more that you share it, the more people can hear this good news. And people need to hear the good news about life.
For sure.
It's really important today in our culture to know that as women, it's a gift to be able to have children. And so we need to learn how to steward that and to do it God's way. And the best way to find out how to do that is through the Word of God. You know, certainly not through social media or the world. Or maybe definitely. Even your doctor, but just read the Bible. It's very clear. And find a good Christian community. And of course, I'm here, you're here,
sure.
You know, and so there's a lot of people around you that are here to support. But I'm just going to close this up in a word of prayer.
Sounds good.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for Rochelle's story and just her willingness to share your goodness. We can see, God, who you are on display through her life and her story, that you're a God of healing, you're a God of redemption, you're a God of love, that you never leave us or forsake us, that you walk with us through the valley of the shadow of death, that you are a faithful friend, and you're a good father. And so, God, we just commit this podcast to you for your purposes and your glory, and we pray all this in your mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Again, thank you so much for tuning in to today's episode of the 1010 podcast. We'll see you next time.